Hello and welcome to News Laundry. Yesterday at Jawaharlal Nehru University, a professor was not allowed to do his work. This professor has written about 40 books, 175 academic papers. He is a professor of English at Center for English Studies, School of Language, Literature and Cultural Sciences, Jawaharlal Nehru University. He was educated at St. Stephen's College and at the University of Illinois, USA, where he earned his master's and doctorate. Among his recent books are Cultural Politics in Modern India, 2016, The Death and Afterlife of Mahatma Gandhi, Penguin Random, and Making India, Colonialism, National Culture, and the Afterlife of Indian English Authority, Springer, 2013. Apart from books on criticism, this professor has published 6 poetry collections and works of fiction, 2 novels, and a collection of short stories. Amongst his latest creative writing publications are Transit Passenger and the novel Body Offering. His edited books include Swami Vivekananda, on whom he's an authority, Swami Vivekananda, A Contemporary Reader, 2015, and Healing Across Boundaries, Biomedicine and Alternative Therapeutics in 2015. He has been the inaugural DAAD Global South Visiting Fellow and Eric Bach Visiting Professor in World Literature at the University of Tübingen, Visiting Senior Fellow, Asia Research Institute, National University of Singapore, and countless many. This professor, who was not allowed to enter his own office and do his own work, is Professor Makarand Paranjape. Professor, welcome to News Laundry.
Thank you.
That is an astonishing biodata, if I may say so. 40 books, 175 academic papers. If I can just begin by asking you, where do you find time to do this when you're prevented from doing the work?
Thank you, Anand. First of all, let me say what a delight it is, also a privilege to be on this show with you, whom I've admired from a distance for your own prodigious output, both in science and in the humanities as a fiction writer and as one of the sharpest Twitter activists around. I said you're quickest on the draw this side of some Delhi or whatever. So I'm delighted to be here.
Thank you.
And thank you for this opportunity. Well, you see, we all know that time management is possibly the greatest challenge of modern life.
Correct.
And essentially, one believes in the rotation of crops. So all these books are not authored books. About half of them are edited. But nevertheless, I think the point is I try to work every single day. Mm-hmm. And that's why I was so annoyed when they didn't let me enter my own building. Though, as you know, in the end, I did succeed.
Right. So I want to actually go through what happened yesterday, because the video that you posted on Facebook and on Twitter went viral. So can you just explain to us, beginning from the sun rose from the east, you woke up and you went to your office. What happened next?
Well, fundamentally, I knew the kids were on strike, the students were on strike, but you know how in JNU, at least in the past, right, even if students are on strike, even a faculty member wants to enter their office or enter the building, usually nobody stops us from doing that. Mm-hmm. But I was surprised to find that they had blocked everybody, even the karamcharis, even the safai karamcharis. The whole building had been deserted, they had locked the front door. And later on, I think the security had to break the lock and so on and so forth. And I went there a little late because I had heard so much slogan shouting. I didn't want to sort of confront a mob. So, and when I reached the door of the building, which was barred by the students, I saw my dean, the dean of the school with her staff, standing out at the back. So they had also not been allowed in. So when I walked to the front, the 5-6 people approached me almost menacingly and said, "Aap andar nahi ja sakte." I said, "Kyun nahi ja sakte?"
These are students.
These, I don't know who they were. See, this is a very important question. Mm-hmm. I didn't recognize them as our own school of language students. So there were a few who were our own students. And when they saw me, they slunk away. They didn't want to confront me.
But in the video, there were students who were wearing the JNU T-shirts.
So some of them were our students, but I'm pretty sure some were not even students, and mm-hmm. some were probably outsiders.
Right.
So I think there was a mixed lot there. There were probably people from other schools. So all I mean to say is that I didn't recognize all of them as my own students. And there were 2 or 3 who were guarding the door itself. But these 4 or 5 approached me, and I said, "You can't stop me from going, even if you're on strike. I'm not on strike." I even said, Junuta is not on strike, and even if it were, I can always go into my office. I have things to do. And they said, aaj koi nahi jayega. I said, kyun nahi jayega? And I said, on what grounds are you enforcing this? On what ideology? On what principle?
Right.
And what is your reasoning? And they said, it's for social justice. I said, how is the cause of social justice served by illegally and forcibly preventing people from getting in? And this went on, the altercation. And they said, you're only one, we are 20. I said, that's all right, but I'm right and you're not, and you know.
So this was, sorry to interrupt, this was unprecedented. First time this has happened to you, you've been prevented. Well, you've been at JNU for 16 years?
16 years I've been at JNU, and nobody has prevented me from going in. Of course, they tried to stop me 2-3 times, and they never succeeded. Mm-hmm. And I know that many other faculty members turned back. There were strikes. There have been strikes almost every year here.
Right.
It's almost seasonal. But
now, you know, here's the thing. I saw the video that you posted.
Correct.
And you know the expression. I think the lady who asks you to scoot.
Yes.
That's one. I think student. I'm assuming that lady is a student.
Yes.
And if you are watching this, I think please hear this question. She obviously. I mean, the her expression showed no remorse whatsoever.
Oh,
she knew that she was doing something which is authoritarian, as you said. I would possibly brand it fascist. But she knew she's going to do that. But still, she did it. So here's the thing. I mean, is it that people change, the students change when they're in a mob, they're in a collect, you know, they're almost like a collective? Or are they encouraged by some faculties, or I mean, what is it? I'm trying to get into the mind, if I may, Professor,
of course,
these students, because I've never seen something like this.
No, Anand, actually, this is very much a part of the ideology of the left and ultra-left.
Mm-hmm.
If you read their manifestos, if you read the whatever their party magazines and journals, this is this organized and ultra-left-wing, you know, groups. These people are very anti-democratic. They're very authoritarian, and they impose their views on everybody. And in earlier days, they used to brand, you know, defectors, denounce them publicly. Of course, under Stalin, they were shot. So this is not new. And in JNU, heckling, bullying, and using force is very common. It's not an exception. And all of this, the point I was trying to make is it's always camouflaged as democracy, right,
social justice
dissent,
warriors.
Social justice. This time it's social justice.
Yeah.
And this time they were using OBCs as their sort of shields. Earlier they've used SCs, STs, and you know, minorities and Muslims.
Sorry,
so I'm not surprised. I'm saying that there's a large spectrum of the left which is actually anti-democratic. And as they approach the center, they become a little more democratic.
Mm-hmm.
So this behavior doesn't surprise me. They were not only smug, as you said, but they were determined. And they had organized this. They had cordoned off buildings. It was not accidental. It was not a mob. It was a well-planned gherao and takeover of the university.
If I can be critical of you, if you don't mind.
Of course you must.
I think you, at times, you're too polite. I think you offer the other cheek, so to speak, too readily. I've seen this before. I mean, in this instance, yesterday's instance, for example, you fell at the feet of these students. I mean, that was...
Well, Anand, that's one way to put it.
Right.
I did not fall at their feet.
Not metaphorically, physically.
No, I'm so glad you put it this way.
Mm-hmm.
Because, you know, somebody would easily say, "Are pair chue tab andar jaane diya."
Mm-hmm.
What I did is I offered satyagraha.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, I'm going to sit here. And I held their feet and I pushed them away. I dislodged them, which took some strength as well. And only then they said, yaar, chhod de isko. But no, it's
this
not
is,
just
by the way, a professor doing it to a student.
Which I don't
that.
Mind. I mean, obviously.
Well, you don't, but, you know, I mean,
no,
I don't know.
I mean, look, if I had to learn something from these people, I don't mind touching their feet the way Indians touch the feet of their gurus. That's not an issue at all. I have absolutely no problem with doing that. But all I'm trying to say is I was not just turning the other cheek necessarily. I had asked our security, JNU security guards, who were there in huge numbers. There were at least 7-8 of them. I said, "Inko hataiye, humko andar jaane dijiye," and they didn't. They failed to act. So it's only when they fail to act that I had to do something on my own, or I would have had to kowtow to these people, which is when I said, I myself will offer satyagraha. And that's how that ensued, right. That sequence in which I sat down and I held their feet and was pushing them away, at which point some other people said, yaar, chhod de, isko jaane do. Then I went, and then I said, aise nahi. I said, izzat se. I stood up and I said, look, this is my building and it's not that you're doing me a favor. And they actually stood aside, the door was opened wide, and then I walked in.
Right. But I mean, the reason why I said that, maybe I was mistaken for this time, but a year ago, you know, when you came into prominence, if I can call it that, for, you know, the shallowness that engulfs us, it's a pity that you had to give a lecture that went viral for you to be known in India, having written 40 books and authored 175 academic papers, but that's the way it goes. In that lecture, I loved that lecture. You know, I loved the way you spoke, the way, you know, the way you came across. But what appalled me, A, was the setting of the lecture. I mean, I'm not used to, and I dare say anyone, a professor in science or, you know, a teacher in science is not used to, if I may say so, entering a Colosseum. It sounded like, it looked like a Colosseum. And students aren't supposed to be like that. So A, I'm critical of you for agreeing to lecture at a place where, you know, there was rabble rousing, they were shouting, they were hectoring you, they were clearly against you, they were trying to berate you. And then they forced you, in fact, Kanhaiya, forced you to answer rhetorical questions that were so troubling, as if, you know, saying, have you said anything against Holocaust? Why don't you criticize Hitler? What was going on? So, you know, I hope you can understand my criticism of you, of agreeing to, you know, I don't know, be bullied, if I can be very rude, sorry.
No, I think it's a very good question and people need to know what happened. And in fact, a book has come out now.
Yes, HarperCollins. Yeah.
It's a very nice book. Yeah. And you'll see that there are only one or two voices which question that kind of dispensation.
Exactly. So there were 25 lectures, by the way. And out of that, I think 23 were supporting the whole discourse, the reason why the whole thing was set up. I think you were, you provided the contrarian view, and I think there was one scientist who was kind of non-committal either way.
Exactly. There were very few, as I said. Now, what happened is that was the venue for all the nationalism lectures. So I had nothing to do with choosing the venue. And I had attended many of them from the sidelights, and they were going reasonably well. But in my case, they had already planned something, I believe, now in retrospect, because there were placard-holding students who had been inserted into that venue. And on cue, they went around with placards and created distractions and also alleged that I had signed some petitions which I hadn't signed. And they
Kanhaiya came in between, started slogan shouting.
That was the big
asked
thing.
Asked you whether you are an ABVP. No, not asked you. Told you that you are an ABVP supporter.
Which I said I was
Why don't
not.
You criticize Godse? Why said, don't you criticize Hitler?
Exactly. So the point is, Anand, the point is that I had no idea that the entire evening was going to be hijacked and commandeered by Kanhaiya Kumar.
Yeah.
And this was a surprise. And one of the organizers who was standing there, see, this was a Januta event. So it was a teacher's event. But when I reached that space, what they call the Freedom Square, there was already another speaker sitting there. And I asked the organizers, I said, what's going on? I thought, and Kanhaiya was already there talking. And I said, I thought this was a Januta event. They said, oh, now it's been fused with a Janusu event. I said, really? And this is the really interesting thing. You know, Kanhaiya got up just before I was going to speak and said, ab main isko chair karunga. So I said, aap kaise chair kar sakte hain? Aap to student hai, student event hi nahi hai. So it was a hijacked event, frankly, and the organizers didn't raise their voices. They should have told Kanhaiya, this is not your event. You should not be interfering. And he also did not show either the spirit or the grace, let alone the conventions of a chair, because he himself started interrogating me after the lecture. It's all on YouTube and didn't allow me time to answer. So it was a bit of a hatchet job. So I didn't have a choice, really.
So you were taken surrounded. By surprise, basically.
I was really taken by surprise, and I can only, you know, thank you know, the wisdom of the universe or the protective powers of the gurus, I don't know what to call it, you know, the great guru parampara that we, as it were, revere in India, starting from Sadashiva, you know, Samarambham, and Shankaracharya Madhyamam, and you know it comes right to your own guru. This is what we are told to revere. Yeah. I have the greatest, should I say, gratitude for that guru parampara, because that's what stood by me. Mm-hmm. The strength that I got that day, you know, just came from years of practicing what it means to be a teacher, a scholar, and a student. I think it is the lived experience and the strength, you know, because you're a, you know, top-rated scientist, well, as well, I as mean, a writer. See, it's only that tapasya that stands in good stead in an hour of crisis.
I mean, that's what I meant.
It's,
I mean,
not ideology. That's all I want to say. I don't interrupt you.
Yeah.
And I think JNU is an over-ideologized place with very little tapasya. Mm-hmm. That is the problem.
So, you know, the reason why I was critical of you is that exactly as you said, you know, this Guru Shishya Parampara, of course, we take it to almost a kind of a subliminal level in India. But there is something to be said about it, you know. I mean, teaching means you have to learn both ways. And when I heard that lecture again, in fact, before, you know, for this, in preparation for this, I was hearing that, I was shocked. Because I do not consider the people who were sitting there as students, not just your students, but as anyone, I mean, as, you know, representing studentship. And that is what saddened me, because I've always felt JNU, you know, disagreement is essential. In a university, it is. But you cannot give away, or take away someone's right to teach and someone's right to respect. And I think that, so that is what, so the question is, would you do that again? Would you go into the Colosseum again?
I don't know about that, mm-hmm. but of course I will, for a good cause. But you know, I want to say the same thing as you're saying.
So you'll offer the other cheek again?
No, I don't want to offer the other cheek in quite that way.
Yeah.
But see, like yesterday, I mean, there were, as I saw it, only two options. One is to succumb mm-hmm. to their hijacking of my space, which
many
I didn't
professors
want to
did,
do.
By the way.
Nobody else came. Mm. There was one other professor who said, "Mujhe bhi andar jana hai," and I held his hand. I said, "Chali, hum dono sangharsh karte hain." And the next I saw, he was missing. Mm. So they had somehow taken him away,
right.
And I was alone. But I just want to say this: that they said, you know, they brought in the UGC notification.
Yeah, that's one thing I wanted to ask you, because
yes.
I am against the UGC regulation, and I suppose I don't know what your views are. So what are your views against that?
Exactly. I may support you on that,
yeah.
But you can't force me.
This is not the way.
That's not the way. Yeah. And then I also said, they said we are dissenting against, the UGC imposition. Mm. And I said, I'm dissenting against your mode of dissent.
Right.
So I said, look at the contradiction in what you stand for. You uphold your own right to dissent, which I respect, but you don't want to uphold my right to dissent against your mode of dissent. So actually your dissent doesn't carry weight, because it's an inverse form of authoritarianism. You know, they had not one argument. They started shouting slogans. And then you know what they said? Please give a talk on social justice. I said, yes, I will. Mm. They said, no, abhi. I said, kya zabardasti? And then I asked one of them, I said, aap kya kar rahe hain? You know, there's a very interesting thing, Anand. None of them identified themselves. I said, I want to have a dialogue with you. Mm-hmm. Tell me your name. Tell me which school you're in and what you're studying. Not one. You know what they said? We are Najib. I said, I'm also Najib, but let me in. Now, here's the rub. I asked one of them finally, ye to bataiye aap kya, aap kaun si kaksha mein padh rahe hain? She said, main PhD kar raha hun. So I said, jab aap कल जाके टीचर बनेंगे क्या आप ऐसी लेक्चर देंगे विदाउट प्रेपरेशन जबरदस्ती तुरंत आई सेड ये पढ़ने लिखने की जगह है सो आई एग्री दैट द यूनिवर्सिटी इज अ प्लेस वेयर वी शुड रिस्पेक्ट डिसेंट बट द रियल पॉइंट इज दे डोंट रिस्पेक्ट डिसेंट नाउ कमिंग टू द यूजीसी नोटिफिकेशन एंड यू नो आई हैव कन्वेड माई व्यूज टू पीपल इन द एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन इज वेल सी आई थिंक दैट इट आई डोंट थिंक इट्स अ गुड प्रैक्टिस टू ट्राई टू इम्पोज वन size fits all on everyone. And in some ways, see, JNU is ahead of the pack, even when it comes to central universities.
Right.
We have instituted things here which are in some ways more progressive. Mm-hmm. You know, in other words, UGC should learn from JNU in some respects, not just that JNU should in some sense be there
take
just
the notifications
to,
on
and,
Facebook.
And just to implement them without widespread discussion at every level. So frankly, I'm very concerned about some of these. But, you know, unfortunately, what's happened, Anand, is that that's given a handle to these same student groups, you know, to misuse this pretext to mount this kind of attack on the Modi Sarkar, you see, on UGC and on the JNU administration. And I'm so sorry that this does not augur well, you know, for our university. That's right. Where I think that the outcome is going to be unfortunate.
Yeah, talking about universities, you know, you have previously said that the discourse in JNU, has always been hegemonic, kind of dominated and controlled by the left. Could you elaborate on that, a moment? For example, was it like that for, you know, ever since you joined JNU, or has it been a recent phenomena?
No. You see, I think it has, historically, JNU has been a left-leaning university. And over a period of time, the left, the institutionalized left, which means the main political parties and their student wings, they created a system that helped them reproduce that privilege and dominance. How did they do that? They did it by recruiting students of their ideology, and these students then became professors. I've written about it, and you know as much as I do. Yeah. If you study in a decent university, in any part of the world, when you graduate, they push you out. Mm-hmm. They say, go and teach somewhere else, go and work somewhere else, prove yourself, and then come back. But I think JNU has a very high level of inbreeding. I would estimate that 80% of JNU faculty were students of JNU.
My God.
I think so. Mm-hmm. You can check, you can do some kind of survey. I haven't done a survey, but that's just my instinct. Mm-hmm. Almost everyone I know come across has been a student of JNU. In fact, one of the things they said yesterday, aap JNU mein padhe hain, aapko is yahan ke taur tareeke pata nahi hai. I said, main JNU mein padha kabhi nahi hoon. लेकिन आपके जन्म से पहले मैं पढ़ा रहा हूं और मैं 16 साल यहां पढ़ा रहा हूं आप मुझे जेएनयू क्या है मत समझाइए
सो देयर इज अ लॉट ऑफ पॉसिबिलिटी दैट द फैकल्टी टुडे वर प्रोटेस्टिंग स्टूडेंट्स व्हेन दे वर बिफोर
ऑफ कोर्स मेनी ऑफ देम वर एंड सम ऑफ देम
साइकिल कैरीज ऑन
द साइकिल कैरीज ऑन बट सम ऑफ देम वर व्हाट वर कॉल्ड फ्री थिंकर्स लाइक निर्मला सीतारामन वाज अ फ्री थिंकर शी इज नाउ विद द बीजेपी सो आई मीन व्हाट आई एम ओनली ट्राइंग टू से इज दैट इट्स नॉट दैट द लेफ्ट सॉर्ट ऑफ डोमिनेंस और हेजेमनी वेंट अनचैलेंज्ड ऑलवेज देयर वाज एन अमेजिंग गाय कॉल्ड जयरस बानर्जी हु वाज इन अ सेंस अ ट्रॉट्स्कीइस्ट And he really exposed the, you know, sort of lack of, should I say, both scholarship and intellectual capacity of the organized left. And some of these organized left, of course, had supported emergency, that supported Indira Gandhi.
Yes.
And
yes.
They were so undemocratic.
Miss Mridula, I remember, he's a, out and out emergency apologist. And she was one of the lecturers in that nationalism series, by the way. Yeah.
So many of these people have been patronized by the leading political parties. And so...
But you've seen, come back to this hegemony question, because I think that's central to the discourse that is happening in our universities today. I mean, you saw what happened to in Berkeley University 2-3 days ago. The same people 40-50 years ago who were fighting for freedom of speech actually rioted, denying someone space to deliver whatever he wanted to do. Now, that has happened in JNU before. The question is, why does it keep happening again and again?
No, but I think, Anand, if one were to try to map the so-called trajectory of the left in India, I'm afraid now they are at a very low ebb. Mm-hmm. Because, you see, they have found their own irrelevancy staring them in the face. And the universities.
Now the question. I keep interrupting you. Have they found this staring at their face, or have they been shown it?
Look, I think that the university is their last bastion. Mm-hmm. I mean, the revolutionary ideologies have failed all over the world. But I must say that if you go to campuses in many parts, of Europe and America, there is a great sympathy for some form of socialism. And that's only a reaction against the so-called, neoliberal leadership, right-wing leaders, authoritarian or strong leaders in different parts of the world. And the young people don't like that, And so I think there's a groundswell of sympathy. So we see a contradictory trend. But in India, what I'm trying to say is that, see, the university is their last bastion. So they will fight tooth and nail here. And this is my point. I'm saying that even if the university were to shut down, some of these ultra-left, they don't care. They want the pot to keep boiling because, you see, this is their last source of patronage, you know, of cheap meals, almost free lodging, because the fees are ridiculously low in JNU, mm-hmm. 20 rupees a month, I'm told, and there's hardly any tuition fee. So you can just keep staying here in one form or another. And actually now I feel they're really scared that if someone pulls the plug, you know, this parasitism is going to be nipped in the bud, and that's mm-hmm. going to be extremely threatening to their larger agenda. So mm-hmm. I think this is going to be a tooth and nail fight, I
is
feel.
It? That doesn't augur very well for peace and tranquility in universities, if I may say
no,
so.
No, because I think, you see, they are going to use, I feel they're going to use every excuse, every social unrest, every form of discontentment in the youth to promote in a way or to perpetuate their own centrality to the campuses, because they've been pushed out of electoral politics, they've been marginalized in social movements in other parts of society. So it's only in the youth where there's still a catchment area, because the youth are still idealistic in India. They want to make a difference. They want to change society. So these people, they harness their social conscience. And a lot of young people are looking for their own identity, as you know. So I'm deeply sympathetic about that.
Now, you know, this is what I find very surprising as, you know, ever since you got into prominence, again, I say in the, you know, the shallow world of how we look at people who are prominent today, people have branded you as right wing. So A, I want to ask you, do you identify yourself as right wing? And B, the question I really wanted to ask was, you have been against putting the sedition charges on Kanhaiya. Not many people know this. So why this thing of, you know, trying to brand you as something, whereas your views, many of your views are in exact, you know, similarity, are exactly similar, or in, you know, coherence with their own views. I don't get it.
See, because Anand, it's very convenient to brand somebody. Then you can dismiss them. You can lynch them mm-hmm. even, as you know. That's how the world works. I must tell you, I was branded even before I came to JNU. Mm-hmm. There was a move to block my entry also.
To JNU?
To JNU. You know, so I'm not at all surprised. See, the fact is that I think that I'm against the culture of branding and pigeonholing and slotting people into categories. And I think that the freedom of the
But
intellect,
you know that, right? You are branded a right wing now.
I know. I've been branded for a long time. But
especially now. I mean, you know, in today's discourse.
See, that's yeah. the point. But I'm saying that I think that the reason I'm against branding is that it prevents people from thinking. And I think that as an academic, as a scholar, as someone associated with the university, people like you and I should not be thinking programmatically. And this is what I tell students. So right, left, and center depend on what context there is and what a person is saying. So, I mean, am I right wing? Maybe I am. And I'm not ashamed to say that if I am. But do I see myself as right wing? I don't. I actually see myself as a liberal, and in the present context, if I were to be perfectly candid, I might also admit that I'm possibly a right leaning liberal, but I'm not a fanatic by any stretch of the imagination, and absolutely I stand for the autonomy of universities. I stand for freedom of speech. I stand for dissent. I stand for all those things that classic liberalism stood for. So, and I say to my students.
And you're willing to listen or call anyone
exactly
to come to JNU and give a speech, even if you vehemently disagree with that person?
Absolutely. Don't block this. And this is what I think the so-called, should I say, shallow, simple-minded, or wicked, if you want to call them wicked and fanatical people, on all sides of the political spectrum do. They want to shut down these spaces of dialogue. But what I'm really trying to say, and I've said this to my students so many times, that I'm deeply sympathetic to people who are looking for an identity, looking for a cause, wanting to belong, wanting to engage. But please don't camouflage intellectual incompetence.
Right.
Right?
Right.
As political correctness. I think what's happened in JNU, and this is what I mean by the decline of the left, there was a time when the left, in different shades,
really engaged with...
Exactly, yeah. And there were intellectual leaders.
In fact, your contemporaries, you know, if... So, Professor has been a graduate of St. Stephen's College. So, let me begin by asking you, you know, how different do you find the environment in JNU from that of St. Stephen's College back in the 70s, when you had contemporaries like Professor Guha and Mukul Keshwan? I think Rukun Advani was there as well, I can't remember.
No, Rukun was senior. Shashi Tharoor, Rukun.
Right.
But Rukun taught us for one day.
Okay.
And see, I want to say...
So which one would you prefer? Let's put it that way.
You know, what had happened to college when I joined, which was 77, the emergency had just ended. Mm-hmm. And college had become very conservative again. I mean, people, instead of joining IAS, IFS, now the new buzzword was to join IIMs.
Right.
And why this had happened is that the last people from St. Stephen's and similar institutions to go to Naxalbadi were 1974, I think.
Right.
And then it all shut down. There was the emergency. And there was a huge disillusionment against this radical ideology by then. So I think we go through cycles of idealism, mm-hmm. which often turn left, and then disillusionment. I know that there was the Nav Nirman movement under JP. It was a college movement. It happened in Gujarat and in Bihar. And eventually they threw out Indira Gandhi and ended the emergency. So these charismatic figures like JP were people we admired. I remember I had maintained, I was only 15 or 14 and a half when the emergency was declared. I maintained an emergency diary and I said, this is the end of democracy. I still remember those days, you know. So I'm saying that I was very left-leaning to an extent then. So,
and what do you feel when people say right now in popular common discourse casually that this is the period of emergency? I'm sure you've heard that. You know, many people say emergency is back. You've seen it.
Well, see, yes, but it's very different. Mm-hmm. I tell you, civil liberties were suspended. The Constitution was suspended practically. And people were spying on each other. I've lived through the emergency. And everybody in the opposition was in jail.
So the thing is, the people who are saying we are living in the times of emergency yet again were actually your contemporaries. They're saying it now. They lived through the real emergency.
Some of them
so
did.
So is this agenda? Is this something to, you know, and the other point I wanted to make was that even though you have been branded as right wing and you've probably accepted right now, chalo theek hai, bol do, you know, but when it comes to them identifying the intellectuals, time and again I see, and Professor Guha has been at the forefront of this, there are no right-wing intellectuals, so they'll brand you halfway, but they won't call you an intellectual because that's infringing on their space, is that it?
See,
have you felt this discrimination in this quote-unquote intellectual fiefdom?
Of course, very mm-hmm. much. As I feel, I think in India, we need to create a culture where competence is recognized and rewarded. Instead, we have largely, by and large, created a culture of incompetence, sycophancy, and patronage.
Cabal.
And patronage. Mm. And this is both for the left
and the
right. Yeah. But what I want to say is this. I don't care how I'm branded. But Anand, I really treasure my intellectual independence, my swaraj. Mm-hmm. You know, if I may use that very ancient word, which was once again used by Gandhi and others. And to me, this is my real, I think, strength. And now coming to this, you know, I think unfortunately, and I think this is what the thrust of your question really is, if I were to understand you properly, there's a poverty, there's a dearth of ideas in the left liberal spectrum. And this includes very esteemed intellectuals. They really have nothing new to say. It's wahi purani ghisi piti baatein. And some of them have their information wrong. They're factually incorrect. You know, yesterday a comrade sort of on a website, he actually accused me that Professor Paranjape didn't say anything about the disappearance of Najib. I've written mm-hmm. two columns on it. So they don't know anything. They don't do almost nothing. They don't read their stuff. They don't do their homework.
What comes to mind was, I think, during your lecture of last year, when you were talking about, you were actually listing out the atrocities of Stalin and Soviet Union, one of your colleagues actually got up, interrupted you, and said, give me the proof. Now, I was shocked, so I'm not from the humanities, but I know that, of course, you know, so much of proof exists, not only through Solzhenitsyn and so many other documents, but Khrushchev himself talked of Stalin. So now, you see, when a professor who's your colleague, and obviously he knows this as a fact, when he asks a rhetorical, I don't know whether it was rhetorical or serious, I'm guessing it's rhetorical, there has to be an agenda. He doesn't want the world to know.
That's it. So you see this history of the so-called terrible, terrible mistakes and atrocities under communist regimes, I don't believe is being taught in JNU. This needs to be taught. And in my essay in the Nationalism book, I have referred not just to Soviet Union, but to China. There's right. So much data on China. Mm-hmm. Now many books have come out because this is the soft spot among the Maoists and others of what's happened in China.
And 60 million people were killed.
Well, huge numbers, and there's enough evidence. I've listed the sources there. Mm-hmm. And let's not forget the Red Terror, the scourge of the Khmer Rouge and all of these, and even North Korea today. So I think that there is an attempt to keep the cadres from knowing some of this. And I think that one of the saddest things for me is that today's left is not a thinking left, it would seem, anymore. And this is also true of many of the liberals who have not produced challenging work, and they've not produced any new ideas for a long time. And all they can say is right wing has no intellectuals, mm-hmm. because whoever is not of their dispensation, they can afford to ignore and just point to, let's say, the RSS or some Sangh Parivar journals or so to speak, scholars affiliated to them and say, show us their publications. Mm-hmm. But they're not looking at the wider spectrum. Yeah. They're not looking at even people like you. They're not looking at hundreds of others who have written amazing stuff, not only in India, but all over the world.
Right. So as I say, it's probably very rarely do you find a faculty or a teacher who's impressionable mind. I mean, you form your mind and you hardly change. But what is worrisome is the students. The students are definitely impressionable. They are here in a university to learn. And if they learn the wrong stuff, it makes it doubly difficult to make them unlearn it and then learn the right thing. So do you think the increasing clout of the student wings of political parties across the spectrum, ABVP, SFI, and all these things, have actually ruined the whole university space, and should they be banned? I personally feel they should be banned.
Well, I'm not for banning, whether it's banning books or such political activities. Mm-hmm. But I do think that perhaps this cycle has also reached possibly a peak and it'll decline. That is the cycle of these political parties hijacking campuses. Because you and I know, and we talk to so many of our JNU students, not everybody supports them, only a small group. So it's more a politics of hijacking now.
But then again, Professor, the point
like
is...
Like in science schools, I'm sorry to interrupt, you're in a science school. Mm-hmm. You know, most of your students don't support this.
Yeah.
And I can tell you, even in humanities, even in languages and social sciences, most students do not support these people, but they are the most vociferous.
So that's precisely the point. I mean, many students, and I dare say a lot of faculty as well, have begun to see this as an opportunity to kind of put, take baby steps towards politics. I mean, for example, Kanhaiya, no disrespect to him. I don't think he cares two hoots about his PhD right now. Or, I'm sure he did at one point of time. He knows he has made his, baby steps into politics, and he's going to be a politician.
See, that was the JNU way. Yeah. We've had famous...
And in St. Stephen's, the student wings of political parties is banned.
Yes, because in St. Stephen's, they
and
don't...
And that hasn't affected the debate or the culture. It
exactly.
Hasn't gone
worse. Well, even in IITs, mm-hmm. no political...
IITs, there is no,
So, you see...
So that's what I meant by... even I stand against banning. But in this case, you have a constrained space of university, and you know what devastation a political party and the student wing can cause.
So one can do this. Yeah. One can.
What's the solution?
Well, one can talk about organized political parties not having, student wings of organized political parties should not, you can say, shouldn't be allowed to participate. So that, in other words, students should form their own groups.
Right.
That's a possibility. Yeah. But look,
because I mean, right now we're not talking of ABVP because it's JNU, but we know in a lot of universities, it's actually not the the communist student wings, but ABVP that creates a lot of ruckus. And in you know, the Congress wing, I think NSUI. So it's across the spectrum. It's
and,
not just
and in all these cases. Mm-hmm. That's how they build their, as you said, their political foundations. Yeah. Later on, they get picked up.
It's a badge of honor, basically.
But I'm more concerned about the decline or the dumbing down of higher education in India, mm-hmm. especially in the humanities and social sciences. And I think the over-politicization of Indian campuses just makes us an exporter of brain power. Even my own brightest students, they go abroad to study. So that we have not created an atmosphere even for India-related research topics to be conducted in India. Mm-hmm. So this is just a stepping stone and everyone leaves. So Indian universities are being destroyed by this kind of politics, virulent, negative, you might even call it anti-national, but it's certainly anti-democratic. This kind of politics is reducing not only the space of debate and dissent, but also the space for real academics. So this dumbing down of our best universities is what causes me grievous concern about our future generations.
So are you for the Lingdo Committee recommendations?
Yes, by and large. Why not? And one great recommendation,
I mean, just to mention, in the last Delhi University election, 5 crores was spent by one political party.
Can you imagine?
Five crores.
How much?
Not even MLAs or MPs probably spent that amount.
So it's so prestigious, and so is JNU. And that's why in earlier times, no student, almost hardly any students were ever rusticated, mm-hmm. were ever suspended. You know, they were always saved. There was always political sort of backstage manipulation. So no rules, as it were, the rule of law was always, and as you might say, there was collusion. Mm-hmm. So you know, students would go and do something, then they would be saved by those same faculty members. Mm-hmm. But see, I think one of the great things about Lingdo is the same people cannot be office bearers again.
Correct.
Otherwise, Kanhaiya Kumar, mm-hmm. since you're naming him, mm-hmm. and I must say that you're absolutely right, all my academics didn't give me as much attention as just standing up against him one day. So that also shows us the poverty yeah. of our own public culture in
That's
India.
That's why I say it's shallow. You're coming to prominence over your lecture. I see it as a double-edged sword. You know, it's very good that you have, and you've started writing columns now, weekly columns, and you know, you're into prominence. But at the same time, it also is reflective of our society.
Precisely.
That unless a person gains controversy, you know, or
notoriety,
if I can, I didn't want to use that word, but you know, you don't come into prominence.
Precisely. But as I said, because of Lingdo, mm-hmm. you know, such people are not being re-elected. Otherwise, you could be re-elected.
But that's just one of the
recommendations.
I mean, a host of other recommendations have not been followed.
So I hope eventually
But would you
followed.
Believe JNU would be a much better place for interaction between teachers and students or within students if you completely do away with, you know, BJP, CPI, Congress, bringing in their viciousness into universities?
Look, possibly, yes. Mm-hmm. But I think that there's something to be said about the political culture of JNU as well, because it's very vibrant. It's full of, I would think, many interesting forms of mobilization. And it is a democratic space. You just have to listen to the presidential debates. You know, people come from all over India, sometimes from abroad, just to listen to it. So I think the complete shutting down or destruction, not just of JNU, but even of its political culture, would be also sad. It would also be a loss.
No, I don't mean the political culture. I meant just the political parties getting into this.
I guess they should be regulated. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I just wanted to say that coming back to Lingdo, mm-hmm. you know, for I think one and a half years.
So that committee, I think, had Professor Pratap Bhanu Mehta is one of the members as well, if I'm
of
not mistaken.
Course.
And they did a survey and they found across universities, 83% of respondents were the students. They said political parties should not be allowed inside
agree.
Campuses.
But
83%.
What I'm simply saying is, look at what happened in JNU. Mm-hmm. You know, the Junusu, they went on a perpetual protest against Lingdo.
Right, right.
For 1.5 years,
yes.
No elections were held. And
yeah.
then they had to accept. So
yeah.
you see, they lost. In
mm-hmm.
other words, they wanted Lingdo to be rolled back.
Yeah.
That did not happen. Mm-hmm. So, see, they're flexing their muscles, but they also see their limits. Mm-hmm. And in other words, that when things are rational and supported by the majority of people, both in India and within the campus, you know, things can be changed. So, you know, Anand, I'm all for a transformation of JNU. I'm not for a destruction of JNU.
Of course.
And what I feel is, look, we are suffering.
And in fact, in the last 1 year, if I may say so, so much has happened. In fact,
so
there's the last couple
happened.
Of questions I wanted to ask you. So it started with, you know, that Bharat Ke Tukde speech, Kanhaiya being arrested, then the vice chancellor being harrowed, then Najib disappearing, which is terribly sad. And it's appalling that, you know, the police has not come up with the solution to that. And now this, what the heck is going on? I mean, do you think this is, obviously all this is unprecedented. It's happened in the last 1 year. You've been there for 16 years in JNU. Do you see this escalating further because BJP is in power? Or do you think this will die down? Or, you know, what is your opinion?
Anand, you know, there's going to be an anniversary 2 days from now. 9th is the anniversary of that event,
right,
which triggered this whole
Bharat
crisis.
Bharat Ke Tukde slogan thing.
Yes, so I'm afraid that we may be in for more turmoil and trouble on our campus. My feeling is that we are making two kinds of mistakes here. By we, I mean the political parties, the administration, all of us. See, on the one hand, there is the view of the left and a lot of the people in the JNU book that JNU is exceptional. So I call it JNU exceptionalism. And so should be treated in a completely different way from all the norms and so forth, you know. So that's one end of the spectrum. The other side is the view, which I'm afraid that people on the right and the admin and maybe political people also think, that JNU should be flattened. The same treatment should be meted out to JNU as everybody else. And as a person who recommends intermedial hermeneutics, I feel we have to steer a course between them, these two extremes. I really think that not only the administration, but everyone concerned, including MHRD, must handle this with great sensitivity so that we don't destroy this wonderful university, but at the same time, very firmly try to transform its culture and check the distortions and all the bad tendencies, you know, that have crept in. And from my experience, I think there are people in the JNU administration who are quite aware of the subtleties, and they do want to do the right thing. I hope they succeed. I hope that people support them. But I'm also afraid at times that, you know, things may go from bad to worse. And that the degree of competence, the degree of sensitivity, and the degree of consultation, you know, and the degree of thought required really to make a difference is not yet forthcoming. Sometimes I worry about that. The degree of consultation, the degree of deep thinking, and the degree
camaraderie between faculty.
All of that that's required to make this transition or transformation of JNU is not yet forth.
So if there are three last questions, Professor, I'm sorry we've taken so much of your time, and you have to catch a flight as well. So a last question, if you were to make three recommendations or three changes in JNU and recommend it to MHRD or the government, anyone listening, what would those three changes be?
See, Anand, I don't think even if I were to do that, I would ever do it in a public forum.
Right, okay.
I don't see, we are both from JNU.
Yeah.
And I don't think it's right for us to be going to the media with this. And I want to tell you, there are enough channels of communication still open. And I hope there are enough people to listen to our voices should we really want to make constructive suggestions.
Right. Thank you so much. And
thank
let
you.
Me just add that ever since, you know, the whole fracas broke out last year, JNU has been in the news for all the wrong reasons. But today, as it happens, there is some good news. It has been chosen as India's best central university.
Wow.
Yeah.
Congratulations
so,
to you.
To you. Thank you so much. It was
thank
a pleasure.
You. Thank you.
If you like that, click here to support us and down here to subscribe to our YouTube channel, and do check out the other stuff we do, like News Laundry interviews, Why So Serious, animations, comics, panel discussions, podcasts, which are really big, and much, much more.